So apparently I did this so well last year that they invited me to do this again, and we're going to give it another shot, and we're, like Brian said, we're going to try it out in this fashion. Normally, if you're brand new to the 131 space, this is not what it looks like on Sunday mornings. Usually we have a number of rows and three aisles and or two aisles, so glad to have you exploring this different setting with us tonight. And if I have not yet personally met you, my name is Matt Plotkin. I'm the director of youth ministry here, and it's a joy to share this evening with all of you. Join me in prayer, and then we're going to hop right into the text. So, Lord, thank you for tonight. Thank you for what tonight symbolically means to us and for us. Lord, I thank you that the men and the women that were present in the room with you were able to record what you said and what you did, and that we get to, centuries later, not just ponder, but then put it into practice. Lord, I thank you that you are a God who isn't just about words, that you are a God that follows through in your words in action. Lord, tonight as we come around this table, may this be a holy night and a night of remembrance and a night where we are able to, as a community and as individuals, walk away having drawn closer to you. And Lord, just for me personally, would you be able to speak through me? May my words honor you and bless the ears that hear. We pray this in your name. Amen. So I'm going to read from John 13, verses 4 through 17. So you can follow along, or you can close your eyes and listen, or choose your own adventure. Jesus rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments and, taking a towel, tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, do not wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "What I am doing to you, you do not understand now, but afterward, you will understand." And Peter said to him, "You shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "If I do not wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "The one who has bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but it is completely clean. And you are clean, but not every one of you." For he knew who was to betray him, and that is why he said, "Not all of you are clean." When he had washed their feet and put on his outer garments and resumed his place, he said to them, "Do you understand what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that you also should do just as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." Amen. So currently, I am not only the youth director here, but I am also a volunteer baseball coach. And I just jumped into this. I have never coached baseball before. I have played lots and lots of baseball, and baseball is in my family. My brother ended up playing independent professional baseball, and I helped him with everything he knows. And so a couple weeks ago, it was about mid-March when somebody in this room posted on Facebook a desperate call for a coach for a 13-year-old baseball team. And my wife pleasantly volunteered me that I was going to be coaching. And I was like, all right, what's this going to do? How is this going to change my life? And how do I go about coaching baseball? I have coached in the past, but coached a very different sport, coached volleyball. And so baseball would be new for me in terms of coaching. I know the fundamentals, and I know the basics, but I have never put together a practice plan and all that and run a whole practice. So luckily, there was one other person who was associated with the team who also was like, hey, I can help coach. And I was like, great. Looks like we have a coaching team. And so there's three of us who are participating as the kind of co-coaches. And we are just about a month in, and we are learning from the kids as much as they are from us, because we're trying to figure out what we need to coach them up in. But it always starts with the basics, with the fundamentals. And one of the things that I yell out to one of my pitchers in a game, in between pitches, when they seem a little shaky or a little off, is I yell out to them, you're just playing catch. Throw the ball to the mitt. Just playing catch. And it reminds that kid, hopefully, the pitcher, hey, it's just about back and forth. I'm just playing catch. I don't need to get all complicated about where I'm trying to throw and try to aim the ball. Just out here playing catch. And it was something that I learned from my dad when I also was growing up and learning baseball. It was one of the things that I heard other coaches yell out to me and other players, just playing catch. Because really, at the heart of baseball is the fundamental of throwing and catching. I use that and I bring that up because in this passage, there are basics and fundamentals that, as, at least in my opinion, as mature Christians, we could be like, that's like the fundamentals. Like, let's get into some deep theology and let's like really chew up like what, where's God going? What's Jesus doing? Why do we need to focus in on these small, little, basic, elemental actions of washing feet or loving another person? Like, I got that. Yet for some reason, John, the author here in this text, he brings us these fundamentals to remind us of something. And I want to lift up these three reminders for us. And the first goes like this. Being in the plans of Jesus includes us letting him have his way, even when it's awkward, even when it's too close for comfort, or it seems too lowly of Jesus to actually be doing what it is that Jesus might be doing. You see, Jesus let Peter know that Peter needed to be washed. And Peter's response was, "You shall never wash my feet." And in fact, in the actual Greek translation, the way that John writes this, it's very strong and emphatic. It's not a double negative. But what John is trying to communicate is that Peter is so outrageous about the fact that Jesus is about to do this foot washing that there's never. You will never. And it's not maybe what we might assume, this kind of cursory, like, oh, Jesus, come on, stop playing around. Like, you're not going to do that, really. It's almost like Peter is so outraged that he might actually leave the room if Jesus were to do this. But Jesus needs to wash the feet of Peter. It's almost as if Jesus' response in verse 8 is this: if I can't wash, aka forgive you, Peter, you can't have my presence. This action puts Peter and us in one of the more confusing and awkward positions. I don't know about you, but sometimes when Jesus is active in my life in ways that don't make sense, I get really befuddled, and it's kind of this awkward, like, oh, what? Wait, Jesus, what are you doing? Because it's not making sense, and I don't know what I'm supposed to do now. It makes sense when Jesus is out in front and leading, but when Jesus turns the table and begins to serve me, it gets real awkward because I'm supposed to be the servant, right? I'm supposed to serve Jesus. But when Jesus flips the script and says, let me serve you, let me be in the lowly position, things get confusing and awkward. And they did for Peter in that moment. The other awkward and confusing piece is that Jesus was about to do something extremely intimate. Jesus was about to handle another man's feet. And it wasn't his role. It wasn't his position. Tonight, when you're invited to participate in the foot washing, this may challenge your comfort level, and that's okay. And if you feel like this is a little too over the top, you're invited to just hang out and pray. Sometimes, though, the action of Jesus getting into our lives, cleaning where we need to be cleaned, is awkward, befuddling, and confusing. And if you're anything like me, there are times where I don't want to have Jesus a part of that. And I try, as almost as if Peter did, I try to get out of that situation. I try and push my way, and I get emphatic, and I'm, no, no, you don't have access to that portion of me, Jesus. Some of you may have read Unger's little booklet, My Heart, Christ's Home, and there's this moment by moment detail where Unger explains and uses this beautiful analogy of Jesus walking through the heart as if it's a home and walks around and cleans up the rooms and eventually gets to this one closet. And the narrator gets in front of the door and says, no, I got this one, Jesus. It's all good. I'll take care of this one. You did a great job doing all the rest of the rooms. This house looks wonderful. But this closet, this door remains locked because that's for me. I can identify with that. I don't know if you can, but I know that there are moments in my life where I want to take care of, and I want to clean, and I want to handle that section of my soul. Secondly, Jesus gives us an example or a pattern to follow. Simply put, the pattern is putting others in front of ourselves, putting others above ourselves. And we know famously Paul reiterates that in Philippians 2. But really, it's a concept that is in some ways still a fundamental and basic that we, I know I do have this problem, where I don't like putting other people in front of me. I don't like being at the bottom rung. I enjoy having the seat that I think I can claim. And so Jesus, in verse 15, says to the disciples, "For I have given you an example that you should do just as I have done to you." The feet washing symbolizes humility and service. The disciples have been quarreling with each other. And if you read from Mark or Luke, the lead up and the moment where Jesus and the disciples are in Jerusalem during that actual week, the disciples are at each other's neck. They're quarreling about who's going to be the greatest. Who's going to have the best seat? Of course, second to Jesus. But there's almost like, no, I've got it. And even at one moment, there's a mother of two of them who come to Jesus and say, hey, Jesus, is it all right if my boys are on the seat right next to you? So the disciples are in this moment, prior to this meal, attempting to divide who has what, who is the most important, second to Jesus. And that's for a number of reasons, really. One is that as we celebrated on Sunday, this last week, Palm Sunday, Jesus has had his triumphal entrance into Jerusalem. And everyone in the city of Jerusalem is peaked with expectation and energy. And the city is already brimming with more people than it can handle for the festival. And they're all waiting. Okay, is this the moment that Jesus is going to do the thing where he ushers in his kingdom that he keeps talking about? And the disciples are like, yes, we're going to be on top. I can't wait. Because we've always been kind of the lowly. I was a fisherman, and now I can be like second man in charge. Here we go. Let's do this. Jesus does the unexpected and puts the towel around him. And then says, this is the pattern. This is the example. One theologian puts it this way: Jesus feared nothing for his church so much as the pecking order and the hierarchical leveling and assignments. The disciples knew that their master was establishing a kingdom. This single word, kingdom, was fitted to awaken in them ideas of dominion in the earthly sense for this reason. Jesus shows them that in his kingdom, the means of mounting higher is to descend. And the way to first place is to put oneself without hesitation in the last. Thirdly, what John reminds us of is trust in the practice and the pattern. For as you do, God will bless you. In verse 17, if you know these things, Jesus says, blessed are you if you do them. Another way of saying this verse is like this. If you understand these things that I have done for you, you will be so deeply blessed if you just put them into practice. I want to share this last quote with you. It comes from a professor of mine when I was at Whitworth years ago. He had already started his commentary on the book of John and the Gospel of John, and it was about three or four years ago when he finally finished. So I think he spent some 20 years on this commentary. His name is Dale Bruner, and he puts this last nugget as in this way. Jesus's foot washing is itself so profound that the following chapters of sermons could almost be dispensable. If all that is present in this single act could be assimilated and trusted. Basically, if we put our stake, if we moved our everything to the center and said, we're in on this. We're in on practicing and following the example set. That sums up everything else Jesus says. If we continue to be people who practice the concept of serving one another, and later when Jesus says, love one another as I love you, if we simply live into those two commands and examples, our life will be richly blessed. That sounds pretty good to me. In this passage, John reminds us that Jesus washes the places that need washing. And it makes us uncomfortable. We are reminded that this is the pattern that Jesus wants us to follow. Ultimately, when we do this, God blesses us. We are washed in order to wash others. Peter could not partake in what Jesus had unless Peter allowed the washing to occur in the first place. Friends, let that be a reminder tonight that we are washed in order to be washers. Let yourself be washed so that you can go out and be washers, people that serve one another and love one another as Jesus has loved us. That being said, we're going to do this in a symbolic way. Almost just as they did centuries ago, you are invited to either couple up or you can come solo on your own. There will be 5 foot washing stations. You are welcome to participate in any way you wish. If you wish to abstain, that's totally fine. No one's going to be watching and judging. There are 5 stations. There's one in that corner. There's one right here. There'll be one at the center here. We've got one on the side, and we have one in the back corner over there. We have one person at each of the stations who will greet you and welcome you and hand you a towel. And if you come alone, one of the people who is manning the stations will gladly receive you and wash your feet. So join me in prayer, and all are invited. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you enter into each of our lives in ways that push us out of our comfort zone, that challenge us and challenge our concept of who you are and the way that you have set up this world. Lord, I thank you so much for giving us this example, this extremely tangible pattern for us. Lord, may we be people who let you wash us so that we can go out and be people who wash others. We pray this in your name. Amen.
As some of you are wrapping up foot washing, there'll be opportunities you can do it after the service as well. If you didn't get a chance, we'll have a few more stations going as we finish up. We're going to continue in worship, though, as we now center on the other part of Maundy Thursday, the table, the communion table. And it was on this night that Jesus was betrayed, and he gathered with his disciples, and he took the bread from the table, and he broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you." And then later, after the meal, he took the cup, and he said, "This is the new covenant. The old has gone, the new has come." And then he told his disciples, his beloved friends, those who he was there to serve, that every time you take of this bread and this juice, this wine, you do so in remembrance of me, in the gift that I am giving you of life. So friends, tonight as we come to the table together, I want to encourage us to take and maybe spend an extra moment tonight reflecting on what this means to you on this Maundy Thursday, what this sacrifice of Christ means to you, what this gift of his body and his blood shed for us, and the gift of serving us through foot washing means to each of us. So we're going to have two stations tonight to come and receive communion, one on each side. So if you're on this side of the room, you can kind of come down straight here, and Luke and I will be serving here. And if you're on this side of the room, you can come down this way, and Matt and Sarah will be over here. But we want to invite you, Jesus' followers, to come and experience these gifts for you. And if you need the gluten-free option, I'll have it here on this side. So we want to invite you as well to come and experience God's gifts for you, his church. So as we continue to sing together, come when you're ready and experience God's grace.